Hey guys, we're Team Sugar. I'm Philip.
And I'm Robin.
And together we make Team Sugar.
We met a very long time ago, actually, in kindergarten. We started out kind of rocky, I think, like kind of like enemies, a rivalry.
That's one way to put it.
but eventually, you know, it blossomed into a very good friendship.
Yeah. We had a terrible start. Actually, what brought us together was Pokemon. Because at one time, Robin had this new videotape from the first Pokemon movie ever. Well, I really wanted to see that movie, and so basically that way we bonded.
I remember that same afternoon I first pushed you like in like some bushes, and
we had
an actual fight.
Yeah.
And that afternoon it was okay, let's watch the Pokemon movie.
And I was like, oh yeah, that's fair. Yeah. I would still like to see that movie.
That's how it goes.
That's how it went.
Well, I first got into music when I was about 10 years old. I started playing keyboard and piano. And after that, I moved to guitar. And it was when I was 18 that I started discovering electronic music.
Comparable story for me. I started playing guitar around 14, inspired by Robin, actually. I wanted to play bass guitar first. It's a funny story, but when I went to the store, because I figured Robin is playing guitar, I like...
Yeah, then we could play together.
Play the bass, and then I went to the store, and I was like, what the hell is this neck of this thing so long? I don't like it. I want a shorter neck. I want easy access. So I ended up buying a guitar too, which turned out to be a pretty good...
Yeah, now we're using it for Tea and Sugar as well, so it's funny that because of the long neck, that's basically why he plays guitar now.
And it worked like a charm. We ended up even being in a high school band together, I'm kind of glad I didn't buy that bass guitar. Team Sugar started in 2012. Well, the start was a bit like, it didn't start per se when we started making music, because before we were already in a band.
Yeah, and at some point, we had a break after that. Like we went to study and everything, and we didn't do as much music anymore.
I mean, it's like a long time ago.
What
kind of happened, I think, was at some point you had this controller, the DJ controller.
Yeah.
We went to your place, we kind of played around with it. And then you started picking up producing
as
well.
But I think even before that, like we were at an actual party, like in a pub. It was like a small party for like 50 people or something. And I remember we were at the party and we said to each other like, okay, next edition of this party, we're going to play here. We're going to go home now. So this was in the middle of the night. We're going to practice a DJ set now. Then we're gonna send a message to the owner of this party,
and then we're gonna
next
play
edition
there.
We're gonna play.
I mean, that was I still remember that night because we were semi. I mean, I think we were a few beers in.
Yeah.
And I know we just went to your house and we started practicing. Later, at some point we created our first track. I remember.
Yeah.
And that's when Tea and Sugar was born, because at some point we were like, oh, we made our first track, which wasn't even dubstep; it was house, and we wanted to upload it on SoundCloud, and we were like, we have no name. And then we just looked next to us, and there was like a teapot that we used to drink like quite some tea. So we didn't even...
It sounded like a nice duo name.
We didn't even put so much thought in it. And it ended up being such a great name, because you can do all these gimmicky things with it. But I would love to tell everyone that this was all like planned out, but no, it was sheer coincidence. And then at some point, our first liquidity, the KDB remix we did, and it got uploaded.
Yeah,
on
that was when it actually started.
When it actually started, and then we were already like Tea and Sugar, and then there was no way back anymore. And then I wanted the way back, but then it was like, okay,
this is our name now.
And that was kind of funny. Yeah.
Who is Tea and who is Sugar? That's always a bit of a mystery for most people. But the thing is that it's actually a duo name, so it really came together because we like drinking tea while producing, and we wanted the name to sound like a duo name, so it became Tea and Sugar.
Or it isn't.
This is what we tell people. This is what we want you to believe.
And the rest, we leave up to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, the Christmas family, unite and make some noise for the one and only Tea and Sugar!
I'm gonna be the one.
first got in touch with Liquicity.
I think I emailed Maris.
No, I think it was even before that we knew an intern from Liquicity.
Oh,
and asked him to forward one of our tunes to them. Then he got back to us, like the intern with Jan.
Jan was the name.
Sent it to Mark Maddox, and he forwarded Maddox's feedback back to us. So Maddox said, yeah, it's a nice tune, but this and this. Like, he had a couple of mixdown feedback things, and we were like, oh, you know, like, bummer, he doesn't think it's good enough.
Oh my God.
And then the next day, Philip called me. Look at YouTube, they uploaded the track.
Yeah, I remember I was literally cycling, I was back in uni and I was cycling home, and at some point I have a notification on for like a Liquicity upload, so I got to upload and I look at this notification, I'm like,
yeah,
what the f*** is our name on there?
It was really unreal at that point.
It was really I remember that as the, like, as it was yesterday. I remember where I was standing, I was standing in the parking lot. And I just called Rob and was like, man, now this thing happened. Because that was kind of like our first real goal that we had, to get a track on Liquicity, because before that it was all more amateuristic. And,
yeah, and I think after that we got in touch with Mark and Maus, obviously, and that's how we got in touch with the rest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that the Liquicity community on itself kind of became a home for us in a way, you know, because every time we come back to these events, you know all the people there, everybody is happy, everybody can be himself, you know.
Yeah, it's really open. Sometimes when I go to other, mostly to other genres or other countries also, I feel like we're really spoiled because the drum and bass scene in general, but yeah, I think Liquicity is really special in that. The Liquicity family is like really nice, dedicated, like the music, and the community feeling, that's on number one.
I think that's the thing. The difference between like an average house party or a hippo party is those people just come there to get drunk, get wasted, but they don't come there, in general, what I'm seeing, for the music.
Yeah,
you know?
They don't.
And,
really
and
care
with drum and bass, no
that.
One. I mean, maybe someone gets dragged along by a friend, but 90% of the people there are there for the artist, for the music, for the love of drum and bass, and that's just a whole different thing, and it all embodies in, like, for instance, something like Liquicity Festival. And, well, I mean, take me back there now, and I would say, let's go.
It's like a really euphoric weekend, and also for us, you know, because we get to do our show, but afterwards we just get to enjoy the festival and see everything,
and see so many
such
friends.
A good fight.
See so many friends again, so
we actually never had the idea to make an album.
It was an accident. The album was a complete accident.
I mean, when we started out, we always had this idea like an album would be epic, but in the recent years we thought like maybe the idea of an album is a bit outdated.
With Spotify, everything is all about releasing frequently, releasing singles mostly. But yeah, at some point we didn't realize it, and we were all these tracks in front of us, and we were like, shit, this is almost an album. Then we just gotta do
Let's
it.
Make it happen, you know,
and that's how it came together. So again, I'm noticing, just as with our name, it just happens.
Yeah, it just happens. We just go with the flow, I guess. Yeah.
I guess so, yeah. Fun to realize that.
The title, Sky. Well, first of all, it's very obvious. It stands for the sky, which gives like a very open, euphoric feeling, which is what the sound of the album is about. And for me personally, it also has a bit to do with my trip to Scotland, to the Isle of Skye. So again, Sky. Because I remember driving there at sunset. I believe they had a movie score hour on the radio with like Lord of the Rings music, stuff like that. And it all felt so epic and euphoric. And that was also what inspired us to make the track Sky. Which is the title track, and the lead, if you listen closely,
that was the thing, yeah.
It kind of has a bagpipey feel to it, so kind of Scottish.
I think we even layered the lead with a bagpipe.
Yeah, I think we did.
I'm not entirely sure.
I think it's like a synth, a guitar, and a bagpipe combined. Yeah,
definitely also a guitar there. Oh, we should check this, out, but anyway. And I think also, I still remember the time that we made the track Sky. It was in your old apartment still,
yeah,
in Harlem. And was it like the 11th, how high was it up? 11th
yeah, it
floor?
Was the 7th floor. 7th floor. But, yeah.
And we had a great view, especially with sunset. And kind of when we were working on this track, it was even like sunset-ish at some point.
And yeah, so kind of it brought back for me that feeling, but also in general the view there was like very inspiring. So Sky is, who doesn't like a good sky, I guess.
Mm, albums are full of challenges.
Yeah.
There's a lot of crying.
Yeah, a bit. Little bit. Coffee fixes a lot of it.
This is bad advertising. Tea fixes everything.
True, but secretly you also need a bit of coffee.
I have something in your fridge that I should not forget.
Very good.
I set an alarm. I will set this alarm for like in 2 hours. I bet we'll be done by then.
Yeah, I think the hardest part for me was like we're used to finishing up tracks, but it used to be like one or two tracks at a time, and now it was a lot of them, you know, like it was still kind of spread out, but still at one point it was finishing up like more than 5 tracks, I think. So then it's really hard, you know, because you wanna check the tracks in clubs, which was hard because it was kind of during the whole COVID thing. You want to listen to them in the car, and to do that with so many tracks at once and get them all to the same level, that's definitely something I underestimated.
Yeah, I think that the whole issue with like an album is you've never done a project of that scale. So you, even in terms of like marketing or whatever, there are so many more tracks to put like the focus on, to tell about, to communicate about. And obviously to test out in like your sets, to whatever, send to other artists. So the whole thing is kind of unmanageable at first.
Yeah.
But I think that, I think this is one of the first times we actually kind of use sort of like serious project management to complete something.
Yeah, like I remember that, you know, we have like our weekly studio session, and we used to just start it out with, okay, let's go work on this track. And now it was like we started it out with like an Excel sheet and be like, okay, let's see what we have and what needs to happen. Yeah, and then based on that, we decided what we were going to do that day. Yeah.
So that's I think it also helps you to get more professional doing an album.
Yeah.
So yeah. Great.
My favorite record on the album, that's a really hard one. I think I really like Sky, but I think the favorite is In Control, perhaps, because it's a bit different than what we usually do. It doesn't really have like a banging drop or anything, but still when it drops, like personally it really hits me and feels really right somehow. And we also struggled a bit with that track and had different drops for it, ranging from like very minimal liquids to more of a party dance floor banger kinda. So I'm really happy with how it turned out and the whole story of that track.
It's funny because I think it's so hard to pick one track because it also depends on your mood, but In Control is really high up there with me as well. Even though it's not not a standard song we would do at all.
No,
quite different, but somehow it makes sense. Which the one I also really like is Your Way. Mostly because when that lead sound drops, it's again something different.
Yeah.
But so I think also because you kind of already know what you can do, it's kind of interesting to see what you normally wouldn't do, and those kind of tracks kind of embody that.
Yeah, I think in a way, you know, we're tired of our own sound in a way, and then when you do something different, you know, it sounds way more interesting to yourself when you do something different.
I think that is really an important takeaway.
Yeah, to keep trying things that are kind of different. Yeah.
And still, I'm thinking, I do still also really love the way Days Away ended up with.
Like,
That song just makes a lot of sense. Every time you play it live, it works great. and Sky, naturally. Yeah. So it's so hard to pick one. Yeah, why so am many. I hate these questions about picking a track. I'm so bad at it.
I noticed.
Yeah, I'm terrible at it. I love Sky as well. The build-up is great, so okay. Anyway, there are many incredible tracks on the album. Decide for yourself. Yes, there's lots to be said about their instruments.
Yeah, you want to go first?
Yeah, let's
see. I have your instrument here, actually.
Be careful, actually. This is an incredible story. So this is one of my first guitars. First of all, it's named after Tirza. It's a girl that I dated when I was 15.
Maybe she's watching.
That would be hilarious. Yeah. we were in a relationship, I think, for 3 weeks. 3 whole weeks. Incredible was enough for me to name this guitar, apparently.
I never realized this part. Like, it was only 3 weeks and you decided to name your guitar after her.
But I mean, when you were 15, that's like a lifetime. That's like a lifetime. So, anyway.
I also remember, like, my first, like, girlfriend. On the day I kissed her, I told her I loved her. So, like, you're not the only one, actually.
Actually, fun fact, the guitar I had before Tears was actually called Iris. It was also named to my girlfriend when I was 14.
Yeah.
So, and after that I stopped naming my guitar, so, because I learned my lesson. The next guitar I got is just, like, nameless.
Yeah.
Maybe it's time to name a new guitar, who knows. Anyway, this one is really an interesting story because, this is a Gibson, for those who know, Gibson SG, Angus Young signature, for really those who know. And I won this one actually when I was 14 because I played in this radio contest and you had to send in your top 10 of all times, whatever, rock songs. So I did, and it was Arrow Classic Rock, I believe. I don't know if that still exists. Anyway, at some point I got a call in the break while I was at secondary school, and they're like, you're selected to be amongst like 10 or 20 of these people, and if we call you, you're in the last three, and then you have to answer a few questions on the radio live. And so I was like, what the f*** just happened, you know? So okay, cool. So I'm in physics in class, I get this call, and I'm like, this shit, I'm walking out the class. So I just walk out, the teacher was like, what, you know, what's happening? I was like, this is too important, I will explain later. So I go out, go into the courtyard, I answer a few questions live, and we're in that sort of weird show where you have to like open doors or something, I forgot about it. Anyway, I opened the right door, and I won the guitar, and they dropped it off the next week, and it was incredible, and it has served me ever since. So
yeah,
that's Tirza.
Yeah.
You want yours?
It's funny, yeah, I want mine.
If you put this one back?
Mine doesn't have such a rich history.
This is
like, I also have some guitars, but I never really named them. This one also doesn't have a name.
We should name the new guitars and whatnot.
Maybe we should. I guess it depends on how serious the relationships are.
But to name a guitar, somehow naming a guitar doesn't sound as rock and roll as naming a guitar.
No, maybe if it was like a really classic one from the 80s, but this is actually a new one.
Yeah.
Like, we do have a classic one from the 80s. Wait, I should actually get it as well. Yeah, I'm back. This is the first one we had, and it's one that actually from the like 80s or early 90s, but it's really actually a toy, and it's really unreliable, and it doesn't have many options. So as much as I loved the look of it and like the quirkiness and classicness of it.
It does look to me still way better. Yeah,
yeah, but this one just had a lot of handy options. So okay, a little bit about it. This is a guitar, so this part basically works like a piano, But apart from that, you have all these controls. So you have this ribbon control here, which usually controls the vibrato. So, and you have a pitch wheel, and you have all these buttons that you can also program. So especially with the live show, it was really handy to have these extra buttons, because with this button I could stop and start the music. With other buttons I could mute instruments and everything. So yeah, it was really nice to have an instrument and kind of like a control center.
Yeah. You could switch off my guitar there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. When I wanted to take the stage for a bit, I just muted it.
No, it was honestly kind of convenient because, for instance, when I have to change guitar or put it away, you don't want all the noises. Or
yeah, so it was really handy to then be able to just mute it. Once we had the show figured out, though, we automated a lot of those things. So at the time, I knew Philip would be switching out his guitar. I actually made an automation in the backing track that said, okay, here we mute Philip's guitar. But like, especially when we started out, it was really handy to be able to
emergency,
control it.
Emergency
live.
Button. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Let's put it back.
Bad things that happened during live shows. Yeah, I remember there was one time when we did a live show, and it was one of the first times that we decided to also run the microphone from Mara, the vocalist, also through Ableton. And we had to mute and unmute it for every track because we didn't automate it yet, because we weren't sure in which part she was maybe gonna say something. So basically we had to do it by hand, and then a song started, she started singing, but you couldn't hear her, but I could hear her in my in-ears because that was always on. It was only like the sound for the crowd that was turned on or off. I don't remember what it was exactly. I think it was somebody in the crowd that I knew that was like looking at me a bit weird, and then I realized like, oh shoot, I don't think I turned on the microphone. So then I turned it on, and then suddenly I could like feel the bass in the vocal, meaning that it was also playing through the sound system. And I was, that was it. And the vocalist looked at me like, what just happened? He was like, yeah, sorry.
Well, I think we had a similar some sort of like issue back in the day when we did one of our first live show runs. We were actually playing at
Liquidity. For the album.
Pre-album.
Yeah.
We were doing this live show at some Liquidity in Amsterdam. Yeah. And Stella was playing on the violin. And then we were running it through the front of house, so the engineer was supposed to turn on the violin, but the engineer wasn't there somehow, or whatever, there was a sort of miscommunication, so Stella was playing on the violin, and the violin was completely off. And we didn't notice it, because we were like, the music is blasting, you know, and you have your headphones on and whatnot. So, but Stella did notice, and she was like, I'm just playing here for no good reason. And then after that track, right, and the set was finished, and multiple people came up to her, and they were like, you played so incredible. Well, we all knew that she was off, but we were like, amazing, thank you.
But that's also the thing, if you put on a convincing performance, a lot of people don't notice things, because I also think with like what I just told about with me not turning on the microphone, there were still some backing vocals in there, so maybe a lot of people didn't even notice that the lead vocal wasn't on, because
like,
you could still hear
singing the background vocal.
So
anyway,
yeah,
I think
it's funny.
It comes with, you know, these are the risks that come along with it, but the rewards are incredible, because I mean, the energy you get back from people when they actually see musicians play the songs is just, it's incredible.
Yeah,
you know?
and the feeling of playing it, the playing itself also,
scary.
like because it's a lot more scary than just moving faders and pushing buttons.
Yeah.
Well, I guess for me it was still pushing buttons, but like
more
buttons.
I guess.
So it's easier to
the risks are higher, and
that makes
and
more
for
exciting.
Like, and I must say, I hadn't felt like stage fright or like this nervous feeling in years up until we did this first live show at the Liquidity Festival again, like earlier this year.
Yeah.
And then I remember before we were going on stage, I was like, you know, I had like these sweaty hands. I was looking at you and I could see like a little, how do you call it, like a little
shake.
Like
a shake.
And
it was definitely more scary.
You know, like, what are we doing? You know, why don't we just think we're DJing? But that rush always is I mean, I guess
makes also, it also more it fun. Makes it more and fun and more yeah. memorable experience.
Plus, probably yeah. when looking at it, like probably we're just like seeking out that rush.
Yeah,
and that's probably why you do it.
That's one of the things why you go in music.
I guess you seek out the rush. So, yeah, we're all adrenaline junkies. Yeah. What is next? What is next for us? I would say that definitely not an album. I think we've had a share of albums for a bit. I would love to release a lot of singles and just also experiment, because I think that what we said earlier, you know, it's kind of fun to explore new sounds or whatever, and now we have that time, you know?
Yeah, exactly, because for the year leading up to the release, and I think the half year after it, like dealing with the live show, it was a lot of things that we had to do, you know, and it was still fun, but we knew like, okay, these are the album tracks, we got to work on this now, we got to make sure this is finished, and it doesn't leave a lot of room to work on new ideas and experimenting.
And,
so
and kind of what happened in this whole interview, you know, kind of thinking like, damn, there was a sort of magic, you know, in like you said that one time when we just ran off from a party to make music and whatnot.
Yeah.
I mean, I would like to see if we can try to kind of bring back those things, you know, like for instance, we never drink beer anymore while producing.
Yeah.
We should try it.
Let's grab some beers.
Like, grab some beers, you know, but try like the things, just break the habit, you know?
Yeah.
Because I think that breaking a habit is always what leads to new ideas.
Definitely. I also notice it with like different gear even, you know, like recently we switched dolls again.
We switched dolls.
Yeah, it's like a hard combination where we switched dolls. Okay, but we moved from Cubase to Bitwig, and that was also really inspiring because it's a new way to create music.
Exactly. I think that the enemy of music is like repetition and feeling like you're doing the same thing. Yeah. And it's like, and if you can break these patterns, then something cool happens.
Like they sometimes say, and there is some truth to it, I guess, but they say like, you gotta just learn one DAW, learn everything about it, stick with it. But I think in a way it's maybe not the best advice, because I really like switching it up and being like thrown into a new
pit.
new pit, like a new DAW, and just figuring everything out, and that really leads to inspiring moments. Yeah. I think
anyway, where the future is gonna go, clearly we don't know, but I know that it's not gonna go wherever we plan. That's never the case. It will go probably in some sort of strange direction that we don't know yet, but that's what it's all about. It's about the journey.
Okay, so we hope you enjoyed all this whole backstory about the album, but I think it will be a lot more fun if you've actually listened to the album. So if you haven't done that,
definitely check it out, because otherwise this, you have no clue we just talked about. So I hope you enjoy it, and I hope it will change your life.
hebben mij gewisseld. Ik deed het niet zo goed, ze hebben iemand anders ingezet.
Ja,
ik kreeg een rode kaart, dus uiteindelijk mocht ik het toch weer in.
Uiteindelijk gaat het ook om het spel, het gaat om de liefde.
Het gaat om de pissen.